and welcome to another edition of Spirituality. We're fortunate today to have in the studio with us an old friend of mine, Sister Giotto Moots. Nice to see you again. Thanks for coming. For those of you, many of you recognize Sister Giotto. She's been a figure around northern New Mexico for many years. When did you first come to New Mexico?
I came in 69, fall of 69.
And where, from where, and where were you from?
Well, I had been in Italy, and I had this idea, felt I was quite inspired, you know, that the Holy Spirit or someone wanted me to set up a school of sacred art. And so I talked to my community and talked to the people in charge, and they said, why do you want to go down to New Mexico? You know, why can't you do it here in Wisconsin? After all, the community was situated in Cincinnati, Wisconsin.
Cincinnati.
Whereabouts
is that?
That's right at the corner of Iowa. I mean, yes, Illinois and Wisconsin. It's right mm-hmm. in that corner, very close to Dubuque.
And this is Dominican Sisters.
This is Dominican Sisters, right. And so they finally decided that I told them the reason I wanted to come is because there was, it was the only place in the country that I knew of that had a native religious art, especially in the churches and especially through the Spanish colonial material that was here. And I wanted to tap into that as like a sort of bridge, you know, de brücke. Which is an art movement that they started in Germany one time to make a bridge to those things that were good in the past to some things that would be good in the future.
And they sure speak that language here in New Mexico, don't they? That's great. So tell us, so you were born and raised where originally?
In Chicago. Chicago on the south side, the famous, you know, Chicago south side.
Big family?
Six of us.
What number were you?
Good number. Oh, I'm the oldest.
You're the oldest.
Naturally, that aggressive type.
So you were the pioneer, so to speak, of your generation.
That's right.
And how did you get attracted to the Dominican order?
I had Dominicans, Cincinnati Dominicans, in grade school and in high school, although I never, you might say, hung around with the nuns after school. Mm-hmm. It wasn't something I ever thought of being when I being a religious sister when I was in grade school or high school. There was something that happened to me when I was in a freshman in high school. The sister that was teaching us religion at the time, she said, you know, most of you will get married, but possibly one or two or someone will become a religious sister. And it was almost this thing came into my mind. I thought, that's me.
Really?
I found it quite shocking.
At what age was this?
I would have been a freshman in high school, maybe 14. Mm-hmm. 13, 14. And I completely forgot about it. It was only later on when I had decided that that's what God had intended for me that I reflected back on that moment. And I thought, how did I know that as a freshman in high school when the rest of my life was, you know, completely out of line from that? In fact, one of my friends said one time when I went back to Chicago recently, and she said, you weren't especially religious when you were a kid, Giotto. Of course, my name was Evelyn, not Giotto, but at that time. She said, you weren't so religious, Giotto or Evelyn. Mm-hmm.
But still, at the same time, something struck you, something.
Well, I really do feel that my vocation came about. I entered the Art Institute in Chicago when I was 45.
1945?
1945.
How old were you at that time?
I was 17, I guess.
So right out of high school?
Right out of high school, I went to the Art Institute. I wanted to be an artist. I felt that's what I should do. And if you will remember, 1945 is when all the young men came back from the war. The war was over. In fact, I hardly got into the Art Institute. I learned something at that time about persistence, because when I went to the dean to register in June, he said, I'm sorry, but our enrollment is all filled up. And I said,
this is before quotas of that sort of thing that took care of different genders, different
groups.
Oh, yes.
All the boys had come back from the war.
So World War II is
up.
Over.
Yeah. World War II is over. And I said, well, that's terrible, because I want to. I was working for the telephone company at the time. I was a AT&T operator, long-distance operator. That's how I paid my way through school. And so it was on my way to work every day that I would stop in and see the dean. and ask him. Oh, just as I was leaving, he was saying, of course, if we had this many cancellations, then you could come in. And he had a pile, you know, about that high of those that had already registered. And so every day I would check, all summer long. Every day I would check to find out how many had canceled out. And he started laughing after a while, as he would see me at the door, you know, to see how many had left that. And so it was the day before school was to start, and he pulled my application out. He said, someone that persistent must really want it.
So there's a good lesson for you out there.
There's a good lesson.
For people to stay persistent if you feel the call.
That's right.
To keep going. So now you're at the Art Institute. It's 1945.
Right, and these young men had come back from the war, and World War II was a terrible war. It was really, they had seen their buddies blown up in their very faces and so forth. And so they were quite destroyed, you know, by it all, and asked a lot of really deep questions that, even though I had been raised as a Catholic kid, you know, I just simply didn't know all the answers to. At least it was the first time I had confronted it. So I thought to myself, I wonder what I could do for them, you know, to really help them. And I, even though I had gone, for instance, to Mass during Lent as a kind of penance or something, but I never really had gone to daily Mass or anything, but I decided that I should start praying for them. So I went to St. Mary's in downtown Chicago during my lunch hour. They had a Mass at that time. So it was the result of, I never knew what happened to them, but I know what happened to me.
What?
And it was the beginning of my vocation to become a religious sister at that time.
Go into that moment in time and look back, because I think this would be helpful for people when people are examining their own life and having a sense, because now we have a lot more of delayed vocations. You don't hear a lot about that. I mean,
that
religious life is even an option for people.
No.
They don't know anything about it. And you know, earlier they did, but now. Yeah. So
it was certainly not something that I was attracted to, in the sense that, of course, I thought I was going to get married and have a husband and have children as any kind of normal person being raised. But there was nothing that even attracted me to religious life, and you might say the habit or whatever else. Because I know other people were attracted by things like that, but I wasn't. But I did know I would get to know God a lot better if I became a religious sister. And not only that, I prayed about it a lot, and it seemed like that was what I was supposed to do. So that's what I did.
So why would a teenager, early 20s, something like, why would someone of that age want to know God better?
I think we all do basically want to know God deeply. You know, it's just that we get distracted by other things, they get in our way, you know, and there's so many other things out there in life that are so beautiful and so wonderful, especially at that time of life when you haven't really hit any heavy difficulties, you know, in your life.
Mm-hmm. So where were you, how old were you at that time then?
I was a junior by that time, that I really felt that this is something that I should do. My prayer life became very deep as a result of going to Mass every day. I really do think that God looked down from heaven and said, you know, that's an interesting girl. I mean, she's praying for these young men. I think I'll do something for her. I didn't think he was doing something for me at the time, but he, of course, was.
So you really took their pain to heart.
I took their pain to heart, right, I did.
And it made an impression upon you.
Right.
And I imagine as an art student, people in art typically are very sensitive. They're more open to what's going on around them, wouldn't you say?
I've often felt that it's almost a prerequisite for a deep spiritual life, to be sensitive to the arts in some way. It seems like a strange thing to say. It doesn't come out of any, you know, tradition of development of holiness. But I do think it's important to be aware of those things on a very, quite aware of the gifts of God. It doesn't necessarily have to be art and music, but it should be a tremendous sensitivity to nature or to life in general, because I don't see how you can develop a spiritual life without it.
So as you looked deeper at things, you started to see the divinity or the creativeness behind it.
Right. And I had no problem with meditation or contemplation or any of those things. It's sort of like I went into those states almost immediately, you know, which later became difficult. That's the way I learned how to ride a horse. First I got on a horse, you know, and no problem at all. It was later when people started saying, well, this is how you're supposed to hold the reins, and this is what you're supposed to do. And I said, oh, is that it? Well, once then you become self-conscious. Mm. So I think there's a period of, perhaps it's comparable to falling in love or something. Mm-hmm. You know, it's all so easy at first. And then later on you get into the daily aspect of it, and you maybe you look back a little or something. I don't know what it is. Mm-hmm. But it's not quite so so easy, you know?
Okay, let's go back for a minute now. Take that moment of plunge when you decide, okay, I'm going to do this. I really feel a call. This is going to further my spiritual life, and I'm going to become a nun. Go back to that moment and sort of share with us some of those thoughts you had and what it was actually like.
Well, I probably did something that I wouldn't advise anybody else to do. I decided that I was so unattracted to religious life in itself. You know, I mean, after all, going off to live with a bunch of women that you didn't particularly select to live with.
Didn't know, had no idea.
Had no idea who they were, of all ages, of all types, mm-hmm. of all personalities. I mean, isn't really that attractive, I mean, in itself. Mm-hmm. Especially when the idea of falling in love with someone and having your own children and all of that is so much more attractive. Mm-hmm. So I decided that, this is getting quite personal, of course, but I decided that I would ask God for a sign. And I don't necessarily advise that for other people, but it seemed right for me. So I said, I'll tell you what, I first came to this conclusion when it was right at Christmas vacation at the Art Institute. So I said, okay, between now and Easter, I want you to send me a lily. And I thought, well, who in heaven's name would ever send me a lily? So I'm off the hook, sort of, you know.
You said it to yourself, didn't
tell
anybody.
I said it to myself, didn't tell anybody at all. No, no, this is between God and me. Mm. You want me in the convent? You send me a lily. So he didn't waste any time at all, see? And I'm expecting, you know, like an Easter lily? That's what I would think. But I'm walking down, I was going to get some tickets at the Goodman Theater for my, I had Richard and Mary and Betty were 6, 8, and 10 at the time, my little brothers and sisters.
Siblings.
Yeah, yeah. And so I thought, well, I'll go down and during vacation, see if I can get some tickets for some children's shows at the Goodman Theater. And I'm walking down State Street, and I see at a distance, maybe 2 or 3 blocks away, you know what I mean? At some distance.
This is Chicago.
This is in Chicago, okay. On State Street. Yeah, close to Madison, you know, the big state Madison. So I'm looking down the street, and I said, you know, that looks like Dorothy Lemberg. You know, she had gone in the convent, she was a friend of mine, had gone in the convent a couple of years before. Mm-hmm. And I said, if that doesn't look like her, she's walking all alone down the street, you know, which is totally unheard of. Usually nuns at that time were walking 2 by 2, you know.
So she's a Dominican inhabitant?
No, no, she's not. She's, she'll never forgive me.
That's okay.
Holy names.
Okay.
So she kept coming closer, this person kept coming closer, and I realized it was Dorothy Lemberg, you know. So I ran up to her. She's in her habit, full habit, you know, and I ran up to her, and I embrace her, and I say, what in heaven's name are you doing here? You belong in the convent. It's semi-cloister besides. She said, well, I've been trying to get a hold of you. She said, because my father died, and so they sent me home for the funeral. And so I said, well, let's go in this little one of these little coffee shops, you know, and just talk for a while. Anyway, we were talking for a while, and in my mind, sort of a revelation, this is the lily you asked for. Mm. I went, oh. That was a surprise.
A human lily.
Yeah, human lily. So what was kind of interesting is 25 years later, for it's at Easter time and all the sisters have gone back home. And the sister that was over at the telephone area, she called over to me and she said, we're ready to go into Mass for Easter Mass. And I'm at the mother house and it's 25 years later. And I hadn't told anyone the story, believe me. This is going public. But she said to me, have you gotten your Easter lily, Sister Giotto? 25 years later, the Easter lily showed up. A friend had sent it, not knowing that at all.
That's amazing.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
It's kind of interesting. But, you know, I mean, you did.
But yeah, but essentially what it says is that you can ask God for a sign.
You can ask God for a sign, but you better accept.
You better be ready for
what
it
is.
Anyway, yeah.
Right.
So in other words, be careful what you ask for and think it through and pray about it.
Right, and I had talked it over with her, and mm-hmm. during that vacation we went up to her mother's house, and I thought, well, gee, this isn't so bad.
Yeah.
I think I could get through this, you know.
Contrast, if you can, some of the difference between today, here in the 90s, and what it was like, you know, in the 40s, in the sense of the culture,
so
it seemed
different.
To be somewhat more supportive, I would imagine, for vocations to religious life, or that it's almost, this was one of the few places you could actually do it in the culture at the time, I would think, I'm guessing, because I wasn't there.
To go into religious
life? Well, no, I mean, to foster your spiritual life. I mean, this show is about spirituality,
yeah.
about fostering people's spirituality wherever they are, whatever religious training or background
yeah.
they are, but to encourage them in their right, spiritual
right.
walk.
I truly believe that why we do not have so many vocations today is because there is a great transition taking place far deeper than we can imagine at this point, or even experience. I mean, it's happening all so fast. And I think that what the Holy Spirit is trying to do is to set up some kind of context in which lay people can simply become very deeply mm-hmm. spiritual. And that wasn't true, I don't think, at that time. It sort of was, if you really wanted to get serious about your spiritual life, you had better go into a religious context, into a community. And I think people sense that. And I think today they're searching for that. It's one of the reasons why I'm setting yeah. up Morada de las Rosas as a retreat house,
yeah.
so that people in their ordinary activities can also nurture their spirit, you know? It's a Nike that says, just do it. You
just
know, I mean,
yeah.
you need spiritual exercises as you need physical exercise, otherwise your spirit will simply disappear right away or something, you know?
Let's talk about that a little, because I think people are not really clear about, you know, what spirituality is. Could you give a kind of a loose definition of how what spirituality is and why it's important to people in their everyday life?
Well, first of all, spirituality is involved in developing your relationship with God. That's what it's all about. And, you know, God being a spirit, we can't see him bodily. We're so used to bodily things, you, whatever is around, that it's easy to dismiss him. But he's not only everywhere, he's deeply within us. So it's that process of trying to discover exactly his nature, and since we are made in his image and likeness, but we still are not God, we're dealing with an entity that's very difficult to approach. And I think unless we listen to the people of the past, as Christ, in giving this story of, you know, Lazarus, he says, unless you listen to the prophets and the people of the past and follow their example, those that are the saints, mm-hmm. read their lives, see what they did. I love the fact that Teresa of Avila, for instance, quotes Catherine of Siena. You know, I mean, you have to look to the past to see what the other saints did and what their lives were like and what rules that they put down, more or less, to follow in order to develop a spiritual life. And they say that meditation and contemplation is very necessary. You know, it should be like an hour a day. They almost give you a formula for it. And you have to simply, in other ways, too, meet with the people once a week in order to praise God. Do those things. I know that a lot of people want to go out to the forest, you know, and praise God or whatever, and ignore the fact that it's, you know, the Sabbath day or the mm-hmm. Sunday. And what do they do to set aside time to give to their God? I don't know. It's so.
You mean in a community type.
In a community type
setting,
situation.
You know,
yes.
Your family, your friends, whatever. Because it wouldn't it be presupposed then, when that was originally set up, that people were doing this on a daily basis, alone or
right.
in private, so that once a week then they would come together.
That's right.
Yeah.
The preparation is very necessary to come together. I mean, if the whole context of one's spiritual life is, you walk out of church on Sunday, or and then you the comment is, well, I don't think the sermon was so great this week. If that's the be-all and end-all of your
yeah.
spiritual practice, you're not going to get very far. That's
yeah, I call that the spiritual methadone clinic.
Is that what it is?
You know, if you're coming,
yeah.
coming to get your shot of spiritual methadone, in a way, and that, I don't mean to be disrespectful, but
yeah.
in a sense, you're missing the point.
Right.
Yeah, it's a.
Right.
I mean, you certainly can't get in physical shape by going to the gym, you know, once a week.
No.
You know,
I
mean, you have
it to has
have
to be a continuous
exercise
thing.
Part of your
right.
Part of your life. Okay, let's go back again. So you're now it's the late 40s. You are a Dominican nun.
Oh, yes.
And you're in Chicago?
Where
are you at this point?
Well, no, I had gone to Cincinnati, Wisconsin, in order to be training for 2 years, you know, postulant novice. Oh, and I was 21 when I went, and by 23, they figure, you know, you're ready to step out there. I don't think I had any idea that what the result would be was that I would teach sophomores in high school. That's where I was put at that time, you know, and I thought, well, I enter religious life to get to God, to know God better, and here I am teaching sophomores in high school. But I felt that everyone should have that opportunity. Because
to teach
sophomores in high school. No, not just to teach. Because everything in life is a snap after that. Believe me, no matter what I've done, quite the challenge that those, I taught high school for about 6 years.
What then, subjects?
Quite a few. I mean, I taught Art 1 and Art 2 and Mechanical Drawing 1 and Mechanical Drawing 2 and Religion 1 and Religion 2 and even English 1 and English 2 because I also had the equivalent of a bachelor's degree in English at the time. So,
you're in your early 20s.
Oh, yes.
And you're teaching kids 15 years old, this kind of thing.
Yeah, right.
And you're in habit and you're
in
a Catholic school.
Oh, yes.
Where was this?
Well, the first 2 years I taught in Madison, Wisconsin, at our school there at Edgewood.
Okay.
And then I went to Anaconda, Montana for about 3 years, and then to Cheyenne, Wyoming for a year, and so,
this is the 50s?
This is the 50s, almost all of the 50s.
I see.
Then finally when I was in 57, they decided to send me on for my master's degree. I'd gotten my BFA.
BFA is what?
Bachelor of Fine Arts.
Okay, and where'd you go to get that?
The Art Institute.
Okay.
I finished there.
Okay.
Finished at the Art Institute. And so then I went and I got my master's in Italy, in Florence, Italy, of all places. Yeah.
So in art?
In art, right.
Because I don't think many people would imagine that, you know, a nun would have that opportunity to go on.
Well, we had our own school.
In fact,
the school came the very year that I entered the community, in 49.
In
so Florence? In 1949. We were given this school by Myron Taylor. He was leaving Italy. I talked to his lawyer later, and I was saying what a wonderful gift it was, and he said, well, it's very hard to get rid of villas, you know, in post-war Europe. And I said, oh. Well, anyway, it was a wonderful gift. And he had given it to our sisters through the Vatican. So the process was to give the villa to the, he was leaving, Pius XII. He was, and it was called the Pius XII Institute at first.
For art?
For art and music.
I see.
And
so
on the graduate level.
So Dominicans from all over the world came here to study?
No.
This wasn't a Dominican school?
It was a Dominican school.
I see.
But the Dominican sisters ran the school. But the students came from all walks of life, all places around the United States, different art schools.
Right. So now you're in your late 20s, early 30s?
I'm in my late 20s. I think I was 28 or 29.
And so you're in Italy for 2 years, was it?
I was there studying for 2 years, and then I came back. What happened was really quite amusing. As I finished my work over there, my master's, one of the young women wanted to have her paintings shown. We're putting on our graduate exhibit at what's now known as Villa Schifanoia. Or was known as Villa Schifanoia. She had wanted to have the judges come down to judge her work that was now on exhibit at our school, because they were going to have a major show in the Pitti Palace in Florence. Anyway, the judges came down, they saw her work, but they also saw my work. And they asked if I would like to show my work in this show of, it was called, I think, finally, 23 American Artists. And of course, I was quite honored to think that they were going to also ask me.
What was your medium at that time?
Paint. I was painting.
Oil? Watercolor?
I was oil.
Okay.
I was oil at the time, yeah. So what happened was, because my name was Giotto, this got to be a headline article. You know, Giotto returns to Florence. So as I said, it was quite amusing. And they wrote the whole thing up.
Giotto was who now? Who was the famous Giotto? before you?
Giotto was an artist of the, the late 1300s, 14th century.
Did you choose called that name?
Well, I chose it because, and at the time I thought it was a form of Godfrey, but someone corrected me. They said, no, Godfredo is Italian for Godfrey, and so you better find out what Giotto's real name was, because it certainly was not Giotto. Uh-huh. That's what I was told, and I thought, well, that's interesting. It turned out it was Ambrose Giotto. It was like, it's like a diminutive form of Ambrose, Ambrose Giotto.
Well, it's an unusual name in this country, I would think.
Well, see, my saint became Saint Ambrose, then, and I try to get up to Milano every year in order to celebrate his feast, which was December 7th, and that's great.
That's interesting. Okay, we only have a couple minutes left in this segment, but I want to assure everybody at home we're going to be talking at great length about then, because it was after that you returned to New Mexico.
No, Italy. After that I went to the University of Wisconsin, got my Master of Fine Arts degree.
Oh, I see.
So I got that. And then I went back as dean for about 8 years to the school that we had in Florence. So I didn't know, certainly when I entered, that I was going to be the dean of a graduate school of fine arts in Florence, Italy.
For how long were you then doing that?
8 years. Well, after. So 10 years altogether.
Yeah. That's incredible. All right, in the few minutes we have left of this particular segment, I want to first thank everybody for watching, and we hope that you'll tune in again next week at this same time as we get deeper into Sister Giotto's life and experience and bring some of this art together with spirituality, how they build on each other, how you came to New Mexico, and talk about the Sacred Art Institute in Albuquerque for 15 years and all the work that you've done. And so it'll be exciting. I'm sure I'm looking forward to hearing it. All right. And also telling about the work that you're doing now in San Isidro, New Mexico, and the retreat that you're building. So it should be a very exciting time. So I want to thank everybody for watching, and I want to encourage you to stay tuned again next week and see some more of Sister Giotto. So on behalf of everybody at Spirituality, thank you for watching.